good afternoon, and welcome to the first event of our Greer Herd weekend of events. This is our Division of Biblical Studies special event, which we do each year, highlighting just great speakers in Old Testament, New Testament. We kind of rotate, occasionally an archaeology professor who will come and provide a lecture for us. This year, we welcome, and again, Dr. Bob Stewart and I have kind of worked to orient, and as well Michael Byrd tomorrow afternoon, which I also want to invite you to, is the Theological and Historical Division event, especially with Michael Byrd, tomorrow afternoon back here at 2 p.m. But today we want to welcome Larry Hurtado. Larry is an American, but transported for a while overseas, but he was born in Kansas City. And did his PhD work at Case Western University, Case Western Reserve University. He completed his degree in 1973, which is actually the year I started seminary out west in Portland, Oregon. But went on to teach for several years at Regent College there in Vancouver, B.C. From there moved on to Winnipeg and the University of Manitoba, where he established the University of Manitoba Institute for Humanities, serving as its initial director on into the 90s. And then was called to a great position there at the University of Edinburgh, and where he has been residing ever since. He's a man of many letters, but has some fascinating things. He's a guy who's kept up with technology. You know, some of us old folks are slow, but I invite you to visit Larry Hurtado's blog. So if you just want to Google that and see what, after, of course, the lecture, some fascinating interaction with individuals. And as you'll find, Dr. Hurtado can be very forthright in his response to people who exhibit their less than knowledgeable understanding of issues related to biblical studies. He also, of course, invites you also to go to YouTube. One of those that I reflected on earlier, and I was talking with Dr. Hurtado about, a recent lecture, 2014, at Edinburgh, kind of their beginning of the year lecture, in which he was lecturing on some of the information related to what we're doing today and in the Greer Herd. How the early church, in the context of the Jewish world of the New Testament era, they understood Jesus as Messiah and Jesus as God. He, of course, has been a prolific writer, and just to briefly allude to several of his writings, he was introduced, by the way, to his good friend Paul Foster in this lecture, from St. Mary's Cathedral there in Edinburgh, which, by the way, I invite you, it's an illustrious introduction of Dr. Hurtado, but lectured recently at this founding event for the year at Edinburgh. His publications, he goes back to some origins in text criticism, Dr. Warren, back at his dissertation, and one of his early texts was on the text critical methodology of the pre-Caesarean text, Codex W, in the Gospel of Mark. That later went on to be published via lectureship. Commentaries on Mark, done a lot of work, of course, in Luke. Paul Foster described his work on the Lord Jesus Christ, devotion to Jesus' earliest Christianity, as kind of his magnum opus, 700-plus pages. But other books on how on earth did Jesus become God, Historical Questions about the Earliest Devotion to Jesus, published in 2005, and has also specialized, of course, in Christian artifacts, that is, writings of the New Testament and the early church with regard to how the early church and the process by which they understood the deity of Christ, manuscripts and Christian origins, also God and New Testament theology, the Library of Biblical Theology, and other textbooks, but has been an exemplary scholar in the realm of New Testament, in the context of the New Testament Greco-Roman world setting, but how we put together what data we can derive from Scripture and other texts and how the early church came to process their knowledge of who Jesus was and is. And so we want to give a round of New Orleans welcome to Dr. Larry Hurtado, who will be speaking on Paul's Messianic Christology today. So Dr. Hurtado, thank you for coming, and we welcome you on behalf of New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary.
Thank you very much for the invitation to come to New Orleans. Your weather here is slightly warmer than in Edinburgh just now, slightly drier and warmer. This is, as a matter of fact, probably today this would be classified as a heat wave in Edinburgh. So it's quite nice to be able to dry out for a chance and get some vitamin D. And enjoy this beautiful campus, and thank you very much for all the people who've had a hand in giving me the opportunity to be here, and hospitality has been fine so far. I've had a chance to taste several New Orleans delicacies, and I understand that there's more in train. In the following lecture, I want to discuss features of Paul's Christology that I contend comprise a distinctive and noteworthy version of Second Temple Jewish messianism. To use a text-critical analogy, just as there was a textual pluriformity in biblical writings in the Second Temple period, as is evident from the biblical manuscripts found at Qumran, so there was a pluriformity in Jewish messianic hopes and figures. And I contend that Paul's beliefs about Jesus constitute an especially noteworthy instance of that diversity. That is, I propose that Paul's Christology reflects a particular and distinctive, to use a text-critical term, a particular and distinctive variant form of Jewish messianism of his time. Now, this proposal entails the prior judgment that Jesus' messianic status is integral and important in Paul's Christological beliefs and devotional practice. That has been controverted over the years. So I begin by addressing this latter issue, which, in light of an important recent publication, I believe can be done briefly. The argument that Jesus' messianic significance was an important factor in Paul's Christology has been strengthened considerably in the excellent study by my Edinburgh colleague, Matthew Novenson, recently published, entitled Christ Among the Messiahs. In this work, he first addresses the much-debated linguistic question of how the Greek word Christos functioned in Paul's discourse. A number of scholars over the years have judged that despite or perhaps even because of the frequency of Paul's usage of the appellative, and by the way, the term occurs some 270 times in the Pauline corpus, because of its frequency, for Paul, so it was asserted often, Christos was, or was virtually, a name applied to Jesus with little or nothing of its title meaning and usage as Messiah remaining or of any significance. Indeed, that's been a quite popular view for the last several decades. But Novenson shows, and persuasively to my mind, and it appears in the mind of those who have reviewed the book thus far, that in Paul's usage, Christos should be seen as an example of a particular onomistic category, which he calls the honorific. Novenson defines an honorific, and he's not the one to invent the term. He's borrowing it from classical students of classical language who've noted the category. Novenson defines an honorific as, quote, a word that can function as a stand-in for a personal name, but part of whose function is to retain its, sorry for the technical term, its supernominal associations. That is, put in plain language, it's a term that can function, look like it's functioning like a name, but also partake of a kind of title function. So it's a kind of hybrid form. That is, Novenson contends that Paul reflects Second Temple Jewish usage of the word Christos and equivalents in Semitic languages. The use of the term as an appellative for a figure, typically a human, who will act as God's agent of eschatological redemption. But in Paul's usage, the term is applied exclusively and restrictively to Jesus. So the term Christos or Messiah is a kind of category, a role or a function into which a different this or that individual theoretically might be placed. So, for example, in the second century, the figure known as Bar Kokhba appeared, who was acclaimed as Messiah by certain Jewish authorities. So it's a kind of status or office into which somebody could be saying, no, he's the guy, no, he's the guy. But in Paul, the term is used not as a kind of office by itself, but is applied exclusively to Jesus. Indeed, in Paul's usage, the term is tied to Jesus so tightly that it can serve on its own to designate him. So Paul can simply refer to Jesus as Christos about 150 times in the seven uncontested letters alone. Paul's exclusive association of the term with Jesus is what has misled, it appears, those who have characterized the term in Paul's usage as merely a name. Novenson points to analogies, such as the use of the honorific Augustus for Octavian. The man's name was Octavian. We know him as Caesar Augustus, but that wasn't his name, nor is it a title. It is an honorific given to him. Similarly, there is the figure Antiochus Epiphanes, a second century Seleucid ruler. His name was Antiochus. Epiphanes was neither his name nor an office nor a title. It was a designation given to him. Antiochus, the divine manifestation, it means. And among Jewish examples, there is Judah Maccabee. Maccabee is not a family name. It's not a title. It was a honorific given to Judah. Or Shimon Bar Kokhba, as I've mentioned. Again, his name was Shimon. Bar Kokhba is simply a kind of honorific designation given to him. To cite Novenson's concisely expressed judgment, Paul's use of Christos is an honorific, and it works according to the syntactical rules that govern that onomistic category. As Novenson concludes later in the study, quote, if Christos in Paul seems to be not quite a title and not quite a name, that is not because it is on an evolutionary path from one category to the other, but because it is generically something else. It is neither a name nor a title, but a third category, which he calls an honorific. The great Nils Dahl's classic essay, in which he laid out philological observations that seemed to lead to what he called negative conclusions about Paul's usage of the term Christos, has served heretofore as the key analysis of Paul's usage of the word Christos. And Dahl argued that for Paul, the term had become simply a name. But I judge that Novenson's study has superseded that classic study, and I think must now be regarded as the definitive treatment of the philological question. Second, in an analysis of a selection of Christ passages in Paul, Novenson shows that, quoting Novenson again, Paul does all that we normally expect of any ancient or Jewish Christian text to do, what we expect of any Jewish or Christian text to do, to count as a Messiah text. And in no case does he ever disclaim the category of Messiahship. Now, there are those who posit a monolithic and narrow ethnocentric version of Jewish messianism. You will hear it sometimes from the pulpit, you know. For the Jews, Messiah was a warrior king who would kill all the Gentiles and establish a kingdom. Well, in some texts, but not in all texts, there was not a monolithic view of Messiah. And there are also, though, but those who have done this tend to then say, this is how the Jews understood Messiah, but Paul and early Christianity transcend it with this much more elegant, glorious thing. It's called doing down the Jews in order to make Jesus look good. That's not a good way to go. There are also those who contend that Paul avoided ascribing messianic significance to Jesus. People such as Lloyd Gaston, for example, said, no, Paul never ascribed messianic significance to Jesus because he considered Jesus to be the Savior for Gentiles only and was not a Jewish Messiah. Or in the words of Pamela Eisenbaum in her recent book, Paul Was Not a Christian, Jesus saves, but he only saves Gentiles. Then there is what has been the majority view, as I've said, that although Paul may well have regarded Jesus as Messiah at some level, this was not an important emphasis in his faith and teaching. But Novenson, I think, builds a strong case that Paul's Christ language should be seen as what he calls a case study in early Jewish Messiah language, and that Jesus' messianic status and significance, in fact, form a major factor in the religious convictions of Paul and of the early circles of believers, both Jewish and Gentile, who are reflected in his letters. Now, I'll admit that my appreciation for Novenson's work is likely conditioned by my perception of it as a far more sophisticated articulation and a more thorough defense of a view that I expressed somewhat less elegantly some years ago. As Novenson grants, to take a view of Paul's Christology as having a strong messianic coloring is to depart from what has been the majority or dominant view among New Testament scholars. But I think that's where the tide is turning today. But there are others as well who've reached a similar conclusion, and Novenson has, I think, now given further strong reasons to do so. In light of his work, especially, therefore, I do not feel it necessary to argue the point further. I'll simply refer you to his book. Instead, on the recently reinforced premise that Jesus' messianic significance was significant for Paul, I wish to turn now to several features of Paul's messianic Christology that make it a particularly noteworthy variant form of ancient Jewish monotheism. Now, in referring to the distinctives of Paul's Christology, I mean features that distinguish the beliefs and devotional stance reflected in Paul's letters from other known expressions of Roman-era messianism. As indicated already, contrary to some earlier scholars, I do not present Paul's Christology as a departure from some imagined monolithic Jewish messianism, but instead as a particular variant form, one variant form among others, of a diverse and lively pluriform Jewish messianism of the time. One further preliminary note, scholars have frequently portrayed Paul as a massively creative figure. You will hear things like the first Christian theologian. Now, I do not deny that there seem to be some distinctive and creative features in Paul's articulation of his gospel, and that he was very impressive in articulating them. Moreover, he certainly appears to have had a particular vision of God's redemptive program and his own special calling by God to obtain what he called the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles. But I contend that in a number of other matters, including Christological beliefs and the related devotional practices in particular, Paul reflected, and intentionally so, a religious stance that he shared with other believers, and that unlike a professional theologian, Paul did not really devote himself to producing some original programmatic statement of Christian doctrine, my good friend Nicholas Thomas Wright notwithstanding. In any case, as indicated already, my primary concern here is to treat certain features of the messianic thought affirmed and advocated by Paul, that is, what he shared with other circles of Jesus believers of the time, and to treat these as reflecting a novel and distinctive development in the context of the diversity of Second Temple Jewish messianism. So first, Messiah's death and resurrection. It will scarcely require much supporting argumentation, I trust, to posit that Jesus' death and resurrection are emphases central in Paul's statements of faith, and in the traditions that he says he received and shared with his churches. Paul refers to Jesus' death frequently and variously, for example, as expressing Jesus' obedience to God, Jesus' own love, God's redemptive purpose, and as the model to be emulated in the behavior of believers. Likewise, Jesus' resurrection and exaltation to heavenly glory form for Paul the decisive act of God that bestowed upon Jesus a unique status, now as Kyrios and Son of God, and as universal ruler. So, these divine actions also serve as the assurance of and the pattern for the eschatological bodily resurrection of believers as well. Jesus, in a famous statement by Paul, as the firstborn among many brothers. Obviously, much more could be said, but it is surely unnecessary to argue further. The basic point, as I say, that in Paul's beliefs, Jesus' death and resurrection were hugely important and were thematized in various ways. Moreover, as Werner Kramer noted decades ago, in Paul's numerous references to Jesus' death and resurrection, and this is also the case in other New Testament writings, the appellative Christ is particularly prominent. That is to say, in Paul's statements, when he refers to Jesus as Christ, when he uses the word Christos, it's particularly in cases where he is referring to statements describing Jesus' death and resurrection. This seems to reflect an emphasis on Jesus' death and resurrection in particular as messianic acts or events, an emphasis that likely originated not with Paul, but in circles of Aramaic and Greek-speaking Jewish believers, and was then echoed and developed by Paul. This emphasis on Jesus' death and resurrection is what other scholars also have often cited as one or the distinctive feature of the messianism affirmed by Paul, the claim that the Messiah had been crucified and that God had raised him from death. Paula Fredrickson, for example, refers to this claim as, quote, the one glaring oddity in the early messianic movement comprised of the followers of Jesus. She notes rightly, quote, a crucified Messiah was evidently not inconceivable for Jews. After all, Paul was a Jew and the other Jewish believers were as well. But she judges that the early proclamation of the crucified and resurrected Jesus did not succeed with most first century Jews because, quoting her, a Messiah crucified or otherwise was not a Messiah in the eyes of Jewish tradition if after his coming the world continued as it was before. That is to say that for many or most Jews of Paul's time, Jesus was a failed Messiah. Jesus' crucifixion, a stumbling block, to use Paul's term, for Jews, that contradicted any messianic claim. Similarly, John Collins posits that early Christological claims, quote, departed decisively from the Jewish paradigms in many respects. Likewise, citing as one important such departure, quote, the notion that Messiah should suffer and die. Well, the term departed, as in departed from Jewish tradition, may, I think, be a bit retrospective and anachronistic for the early decades of the Jesus movement and the time of the Pauline mission. Certainly, it appears that the claim that Jesus' crucifixion was an integral and even divinely ordained part of his messianic role, that claim was without precedent or analogy in the other known versions of Second Temple Jewish messianism, and so was a genuinely innovative notion that also entailed novel readings of a number of biblical Old Testament texts. But, to underscore Fredrickson's observation, it was a notion that emerged initially in circles precisely of Aramaic-speaking and Greek-speaking Jews and in the Jewish homeland. So instead of referring to the early Christological claims as a departure from Jewish messianic paradigms, it would, I think, be more accurate to say that they initially comprised a novel form of Jewish messianism. Certainly, those earliest Jewish believers did not withdraw from their ethnic ties or identity. And so far as we can see, they did not understand their messianic claims about Jesus as a departure from their messianic faith. They did not leave Judaism. So there's a sense in which Pamela Eisenbaum's book is correct. Paul was not a Christian. He was a Jew. a Jewish believer in Jesus. Christian in the sense of a goy, you know, a Gentile, something else. He did not leave Judaism for Jesus. Instead, Paul and other Jewish believers engaged fellow Jews, declaring their novel messianic claims with the aim of securing acceptance of these claims as the fulfillment of Jewish eschatological and messianic hopes. Now, granted, these earliest Jewish believers may have met with only limited success in the early decades, and their claims came eventually to be regarded as a Jewish heresy. But this should not prevent the recognition that their claims about Jesus, admittedly somewhat peculiar in the ancient Jewish context, commenced as what we may term a novel variant form of Jewish messianism. For the purpose of this discussion, I want to underscore that this view of their message also characterizes Paul's messianic Christology. Paul was, in fact, of course, a Jewish Christian, not a Gentile Christian. Fully recognizing that the proclamation of the crucified Jesus was a difficult sell to many or most Jews of the time, Paul nevertheless continued to hold that this message is the authentic manifestation of God's redemptive purposes for Israel, as well as for Gentiles, and that Jesus is the Messiah of Israel, in whom the Torah finds its eschatological consummation. Secondly, the interval, the messianic interval, and the parousia. In early Christian teaching reflected in Paul, Messiah's death and resurrection entailed another striking feature, an interval between these events, Jesus' death and resurrection, and the future consummation of God's redemptive program in which Jesus will return in glory. Moreover, the interval between Jesus' resurrection, on the one hand, and the parousia is itself endowed with special significance as the time for the proclamation of the gospel to Jews and, especially in Paul's case, to Gentiles as well, making it the time of salvation and giving it a particular eschatological significance. So it isn't just that the eschaton is delayed. The interval waiting for the eschaton is itself charged with eschatological significance. The resulting scheme in which first the Messiah appears and is divinely confirmed, Jesus' resurrection, followed then by this interval in which the message focused on his identity and significance is proclaimed, culminating in his return, parousia, and the attendant events that comprise the consummation of God's redemptive purposes, which includes the resurrection of all the elect, this all seems to be another novel and unprecedented feature of the early Christian messianism. A third note, a cosmic dimension. A third noteworthy feature of Paul's messianic Christology is the cosmic dimension to Jesus' exaltation and appointed rule. To be sure, among the other various forms of Jewish messianism, there are examples of expectations of a universal dimension to Messiah's rule. For example, the royal Messiah of the Psalms of Solomon will redeem Israel and will also exercise sovereignty over all the nations to the ends of the earth. Of course, various biblical texts posited a worldwide supremacy or sovereignty for the Davidic monarch of Judea as well, Psalm 2, for example. And Paul reflects an early Christian reading of Psalm 8, another royal psalm, as prefiguring the Messiah, citing particularly the reference in this psalm to God putting, quote, all things under his feet in subjection to Christ, in Paul's case. But in Paul's description of Jesus' exaltation and sovereignty, the things to be subjected to Jesus extend beyond worldwide to encompass all other dimensions of reality as well. Note that in 1 Corinthians 15, for example, Paul even includes death as one of the enemies to be subjugated to Christ and destroyed. In an oft-studied passage widely thought to derive from an early Christian ode, Philippians chapter 2, Jesus is given, quote, the name above every name, and is to be acclaimed by every being, quote, in heaven and on earth and under the earth. This is by no means peculiar to Paul, but is reflected in a number of other New Testament texts as well. Jesus' supremacy over heavenly powers, especially posited. Now, we may come close to this for an analogy to this in the messianic figure of what is called the parables or the similitudes of Enoch. a figure there who will exercise supremacy over kings and their kingdoms worldwide in various places, and will even judge Azazel, the name given to the Satan figure, and all his associates and all his host. In another text in the parables of Enoch, the enthroned chosen one even seems to judge, quote, all the works of the holy ones in the heights of heaven, even judges the angels. Nevertheless, the form of the messianism reflected in Paul seems even more encompassing, more truly universal on a cosmic scale than at least most other expressions of messianic rule, with all dimensions of reality again to be subjected to Jesus. We should also note that Jesus' messianic supremacy is redemptive, not only for Israel, but for the nations as well. Whereas in some forms of Jewish messianism, Messiah does subdue the nations and may even inflict punishment upon them, in the vision that we have reflected in Paul, Jesus redeems Gentiles as well as Israel, enfranchising Gentiles into the Abrahamic family. Still another striking feature of Paul's messianic Christology, and one that is curiously not commented on very frequently, is its strong affective tone. That is, Paul's Christological discourse is characterized by a striking intensity in expressing his relationship and that of other believers to Christ. For example, there is Paul's references to his own having been, quote, crucified with Christ, and to his continuing life as entrusting himself to the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Or consider his passionately worded autobiographical passage in Philippians 3, where he declares the supreme importance, quote, of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, and posits his single-minded aim, quote, to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings. Or note his statement of being motivated strongly by the love of Christ, whose redemptive death for all should now generate an answering life commitment to God in 2 Corinthians 5. In other statements also, Paul refers to God's love, connecting it strongly with Christ, as in Romans 8:39, declaring famously there that nothing in all creation, quote, can separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Indeed, there are several references to God's love, typically for believers, in Paul's letters and in the New Testament more widely, and also references to believers responsible to love God in return. I want to emphasize, by the way, in passing, don't have time to develop it here, but it's a noteworthy point. This is not typical of religious discourse generally in the Roman religious environment. It's very hard to find any references in the so-called pagan religious literature of the time. Very, very hard. Let me put it gently. I haven't found any yet. It's very, very hard. It's very, very hard to find any reference in pagan religious discourse of the time to the gods loving people or to loving the gods in return. You find references to the God as merciful, bountiful, generous, kind, whatever, but you don't have this love language. It's very, very interesting. And yet it is ubiquitous in the New Testament. Not typical of religious discourse in the Roman world in general, and so it may reflect a kind of discourse, however, that Paul inherited from his Jewish and biblical tradition, which feature frequent references in the Old Testament, for example, to God's love for Israel and of Israel's responsibility to love God in return. So it's Jewish discourse, it's not pagan discourse, to talk about God loving and loving God in return. But to underscore my point here, Paul's emphasis on the love of Christ and the strongly affective tone in Paul's references to his relationship with Christ as well are, to my knowledge, without precedent or analogy in other forms of Second Temple Jewish messianic discourse. You may talk about loving God or God loving you, but you don't talk about Messiah loving or loving Messiah, typically. But in Paul, it's very, very strong. One factor helping to account for this might be that Paul's messianic figure, Jesus, is, of course, a real known person of then-living memory, whereas most other types of ancient Jewish messianism projected some future theoretical, as yet unidentified figure. It's hard to love a figure that you know, that's a kind of construct. Moreover, as noted, the closest analogies, as I've said, are in biblical tradition discourse about God's love and loving God in return, and the expressions of intense devotion found especially often in the Psalms. We could say that Paul reflects an incorporation of Jesus into this tradition, perhaps giving us one of a number of expressions of what we may term, what I have termed, a dyadic pattern, from the word dyad, in which Jesus is linked with God uniquely and intimately in early Christian belief and devotional worship practice. More on that in due course. But whatever the factors to invoke as causative for it, this affective tone in Paul's discourse about Jesus is remarkable. This affective discourse concerning Jesus seems to be related to another feature, the way that Paul refers to the incorporative relationship of believers to Jesus Christ. It has been labeled variously by scholars as union with Christ, or Christ mysticism, or participation in Christ. The most well-known and oft-studied Pauline expression of this, of course, is the en Christo formula, in Christ formula, which occurs about 56 times in the, again, the seven undisputed letters. In addition, there are related expressions that are used often with reference to believers vis-a-vis Jesus, such as eis Christon, into Christ, literally, or sun Christo, with Christ, or dia Christo, through Christ, and also, interesting, en curio, in the Lord. In the history of scholarship, prompted initially by Adolf Deismann in an 1892 treatise, scholars made various attempts to determine what Paul's references to believers being in Christ meant, and what relationship Paul's so-called mysticism may have had to its religious environment. Near the end of the 20th century, however, James Dunn judged that scholarly interest in the subject had, quote, faded, and that the topic had become what he called a back number in Pauline studies. It is neither possible nor necessary here to engage the intricacies of that long scholarly debate, much less to expound in any adequate manner Paul's discourse about believers as intimately in relationship to Christ. Instead, I simply want to highlight the integral place occupied by this discourse in Paul, in his messianic Christology, and to note that this is yet another distinctive feature of it in comparison with the strands of Second Temple messianism. Although much more attention historically has been given to the place and the meaning of justification in Paul, this emphasis on believers as incorporated into Christ is actually very important in Paul's theological discourse as well. Indeed, James Dunn judged it, quote, more pervasive in Paul's writing than his talk of God's righteousness. And Dunn also contended that, quote, study of participation in Christ leads more directly into the rest of Paul's theology than does justification. I think I'd have to agree. To cite Dunn one further time, he proposed that, quote, as a fundamental aspect of his thought and speech, Paul's frequent references to being in Christ or in the Lord reflect Paul's view that the life of believers, quoting him now, its source, its identity, and its responsibilities could be summed up in these phrases. But we must also note that this centrality of Christ was not at all at the expense of God in Paul's religious thought and practice, nor in the other New Testament writings. Granted, on the one hand, the key distinguishing feature of discourse about God in Paul and the New Testament generally is the prominent place of Jesus. Whenever they talk about God, Jesus always gets brought into the discourse as well. Jesus is the one by whom believers typically identify themselves, and in their collective devotional practices, he is explicit and central in a degree and manner that is remarkable. To quote the brilliant rhetoric that I wrote in my book in 2010 on God in New Testament theology. On the other hand, however, in all the various presentations of Jesus' significance, God holds the overarching and central place. For Paul, we may say, if adequate discourse about God now requires reference to Jesus, it is also the case that Jesus' significance is expressed consistently with reference to God. Jesus does not displace God, or should not, although he has in the history of popular forms of Christian devotion down the ages. So Paul's emphasis on believers as in Christ, that is, in a powerful relationship with Christ, sits comfortably with Paul's larger vision of God's overarching supremacy. Paul also saw Christ as appointed by God as Son of God, the Son of God, the definite article consistently used by Paul, unique Son of God, and as the Lord. And so the close relationship with Christ that Paul defined and described and affirmed was for him the divinely willed mode by which believers were to enter obediently into God's redemptive purposes. Nevertheless, again, in the context of other forms of Jewish messianism, this centrality of Jesus, in particular, this positing of believers in Christ, seems to be another distinguishing mark of the messianic Christology that he affirmed. I turn now finally to note another feature of Paul's view of Christ. Indeed, to my mind, this is the most striking and distinctive feature of all. The exalted Jesus is programmatically treated as rightful co-recipient of devotional practice, including corporate worship, along with God. Having written on this topic repeatedly over some 25 years or more, I shall and must treat only a selection of the data, and only very briefly here. As in my previous publications, to avoid abstractions, I will focus here on the specifics of devotional practices, especially those that appear to be features of corporate worship. We may first note the text in 1 Corinthians 1:2, and Paul's concise characterization of believers there as those who in every place call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. The phrasing, to call those who call upon the name, uses the word epikaleo, to call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, is obviously an adaptation of an Old Testament expression used often to describe the cultic invocation or worship of God, Yahweh. We can only presume that Paul used this expression in full knowledge of this, and that he refers to some equivalent action of cultic acclamation of our Lord Jesus Christ. Indeed, to underscore the point, it is this cultic action that he refers to here as itself the sufficient and common description of Jesus believers. For Paul, who are Christians? Those who call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's it. In Romans chapter 10, verses 9 to 13, we have another reference to this cultic acclamation of and the ritualized reverence for the exalted Jesus. Here, Paul refers to uttering the verbal confession, if you confess with your lips, Kyrios Jesus, Jesus is Lord. And only a few statements later, in verse 12, he refers to calling upon Jesus in verse 12. And then he directly quotes a statement from Joel, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And in the context, the Lord has to be Jesus. Note that in this reference to the ritual invocation or acclamation of Jesus, Paul uses again a biblical statement that originally referred to the invocation of Yahweh. This cultic acclamation of Jesus seems also to be alluded to in other texts, such as 1 Corinthians 12:3, no one can say Kyrios Jesus except by the Spirit. And probably in the passage, the well-known passage in Philippians 2, verses 9 through 11, every knee in heaven and earth and under the earth shall bow and confess Kyrios Jesus Christos, Lord Jesus Christ. Also, please note, the little Maranatha phrase in 1 Corinthians 16:22 is now commonly taken as evidence that a similar cultic acclamation or invocation of Jesus as Lord featured in Aramaic-speaking circles of Jewish believers, as well as in the Greek-speaking Pauline congregations. The word Maranatha, Mar, is the Aramaic equivalent of Kyrios. It means Lord. Maranatha probably means something like, O Lord, come, and is addressed to Jesus. In addition to cultic acclamation and invocation of Jesus and odes celebrating him chanted in worship, there is the place of Jesus in the corporate meal of the church. Paul refers to this meal indeed in one place as the Lord's Supper, or perhaps even royal supper, Kyriakon Dipnon, in 1 Corinthians 11:20. The risen Jesus, rather obviously the Lord in question. Indeed, in another passage, Paul draws a direct comparison with the cult meals devoted to various Roman-era deities in 1 Corinthians 10, where he talks about the cult meals of the various pagan deities and the Lord's Supper and says you have to choose. You cannot share the table of demons and the table of the Lord. Puts them on the same par. It seems we should probably allow for variations in the specific ways that earliest Christian circles may have understood their common meals. We can't presume that Paul's references is a blanket reference to everybody, but it seems clear that in all extant references to the common meal of early Christians, Jesus was central in one way or another, whether as the host of the meal or in his messianic redemptive work. Moreover, Paul's references to prayers include striking instances where Jesus is co-recipient of prayer, as in 1 Thessalonians 3, where Paul implores God and our Lord Jesus jointly on behalf of the Thessalonian believers. And Paul's typical letter salutations, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, for example, which typically open all of his letters, sometimes referred to by scholars as wish prayers, and which may well derive from liturgical formula in the eyes of many scholars, these likewise reflect a striking duality or dyadic devotional stance in which both God and Jesus are effectively linked as sources of that grace and peace invoked upon the recipients. Paul's equally well-known grace benedictions, which typically conclude his letters and which also may well reflect early liturgical expressions, further demonstrate the remarkable place of Jesus. Those, of course, are the grace of Jesus Christ be with you, the grace of the Lord Jesus be with you. Very prominent place of Jesus, to be sure. Indeed, in 2 Corinthians 12, Paul refers to his own repeated petitions made directly to the Lord, who in this context, again, must be Jesus. In this case, a petition to remove a thorn in the flesh from him. By the way, it's a repeated prayer in which Jesus says, no. Even no is an answer to prayer. Okay. To cite yet one more item making up the remarkable constellation of devotional actions, the entrance rite or initiation rite for the early circles of Jesus believers, baptism, dear to the hearts of at least some people here today, I presume, appears typically to have been performed in or into the name of Jesus. Lars Hartman has shown that this likely involved a ritual invocation of Jesus' name over and perhaps by the candidates, signifying that they were now made the property of Jesus. Yes, I know that in the course of time, a Trinitarian form developed, but the earliest baptismal formula was clearly baptized into the name of Jesus. And it also posits Jesus as the basis of their eschatological salvation. Now, I trust that these examples, briefly touched on here, will suffice to make the basic point that in Paul's letters we have a remarkable devotional pattern in which Jesus features prominently and uniquely along with God, and that this is apparently novel in the context of Second Temple Jewish religion and other known forms of Jewish messianism. Now, granted, in context of worship, the key title that Paul applied to Jesus is the Lord, ho Kyrios. But in Paul's letters, the one confessed and invoked as Kyrios is also accorded the honorific Christos, whose death and resurrection confirm his messianic status. For Paul, Jesus' status as Kyrios, Lord, does not conflict with or relativize his messianic role, but instead expresses the particularly exalted nature of Jesus' messianic status. In the foregoing discussion, I've itemized several key features of the Christology and devotional stance reflected in Paul's letters that are noteworthy individually and that collectively comprise an apparently novel development in Second Temple Jewish religion. To my mind, the most striking, as I've said, of these features is the prominence of the exalted Christ in early Christian devotional practice, the dyadic devotional pattern that we've noted. Perhaps the closest we get to analogous figures are the mysterious Melchizedek, referred to in a few fragmentary Qumran texts, and the messianic figure that I've mentioned already from the parables of Enoch. But the Melchizedek figure seems to be a high angel projected as acting in the eschatological future, essentially as a field marshal in the triumph of God's purposes on earth. It is not entirely clear that he should be thought of as Messiah, or how he relates to the messianic expectations found in other Qumran texts. Moreover, he does not seem to play a role in the actual religious life and practices of Qumran or of any other known circle of Second Temple Jews. He appears to be more a figure of eschatological dreams rather than devotional practice. As for the similitudes of Enoch, the chosen one there is clearly a messianic figure combining several biblical influences and even transcendent qualities. Chosen and named, we are told, before the creation of the world, it is posited that in some future day he will be revealed and enthroned and will execute God's judgment even over, as I've said, the angelic hosts. There are some interesting similarities between this messianic figure of the parables and the portrayal of Jesus in the letters of Paul and other New Testament writings. For example, both figures show the combined appropriation of various biblical traditions: the Davidic Messiah, the Son of Man figure of Daniel 7, the servant figure of Isaiah, and even personified wisdom. But we should not forget the noteworthy differences as well. As with the Melchizedek figure of Qumran, the messianic figure of the parables is a projection of eschatological hopes and dreams, or perhaps we should say a product of fervent exegesis of biblical texts, a figure unknown at present who is someday to be revealed. For Paul, however, the Messiah who has been made ho kurios is a known figure, Jesus, a real and recent human figure, in Paul's words, born of a woman, born under the law, to whom Paul ascribes extraordinary status and roles, as, for example, even the agent of creation in 1 Corinthians 8. Moreover, and most significantly in my view, we have no evidence or reason to presume that there were Jewish circles in which the chosen one of the parables of Enoch functioned in devotional practices comparably to the way that Jesus did clearly in the early churches. There is no indication of an equivalent dyadic devotional pattern, no programmatic mutation in devotional practices and life, such as we see reflected and indeed presumed already in Paul's letters. Note that throughout the parables, it is actually the name of the Lord of the Spirits that is to be praised, not the chosen one. And it is the Lord of the Spirits through whom prayers and intercession are offered. Sinners are those, quote, who deny the name of the Lord of the Spirits, and the righteous believe in, depend upon, and praise the name of the Lord of the Spirits, that is, God. In this same name, they are saved in various places in the similitudes, and they will be blessed, and it is typically God alone to whom cultic worship is given in various scenes. In short, neither in Qumran nor in the parables of Enoch do we have an explanation or basis to account for the distinctive variant form of messianism that we see affirmed in Paul. Moreover, there seems to me scant evidence to posit some direct influence or borrowing from any one of these upon the other. Instead, I suggest that the Melchizedek of Qumran and the chosen one of the parables may offer additional and independent further illustrations of the variegated nature of Jewish messianism in the early first century, a setting in which Paul's messianic Christology comprises another and particularly distinctive, and to my view, even more remarkable variant form. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hurtado, for that informative and stimulating lecture. We like to take time for questions, and we have a bit of time here now. So we'll open it up to the floor. We have a microphone up here. If you have a question to direct toward Dr. Hurtado, the lecture and related matters, a complex of items in this presentation, come forth to ask your question.
Hi, doctor.
What's your name and question?
Yes, I'm Charles Radcliffe. I'm a student here at the seminary. I have a question. I want you to broaden my understanding on these terms. I've heard this a lot, even among new perspectives, the Second Temple. What is the Second Temple? Yeah, wasn't really sure. And could you also explain to me, what is it that you agreed with Dunn on? I didn't catch what you were saying.
Okay. The term, sorry, to use a technical term, the term Second Temple Judaism is used by scholars to mean basically that period from the rebuilding of the temple. The first temple is destroyed in the Babylonian conquest in early 6th century. There's a period of Babylonian captivity, and then sometime later under Ezra and Nehemiah, a temple is rebuilt sometime in the Persian period, 420, 440, something like that. And so from that point on, you're in sort of the Second Temple period. As to my citation of Dunn, I would agree, I suppose, with him and with other scholars on many things, but the particular thing I was focusing on there is Dunn's argument that this emphasis in Paul on relationship to Christ, on incorporation into Christ and fellowship with him, he argued was actually closer to the center of Paul's religious life than justification language. I agree with him. I think he's probably right.
Thank you, Doctor. My name's Sean, undergrad student here. So my question comes actually from an argument in Dr. Ehrman's book. He uses the idea of the pre-Pauline creeds and his opinion that Paul added stuff to change them, in specific like Romans, I think it's 1:3-4. And that's what I was thinking because for me, when I was reading it, I kind of, in my novice opinion, thought like it could actually support like a high Christology for the early church, as well as when I heard yours, that it would really support a messianic, distinct messianic Paul's Christology. So I was wondering, is there any relevancy or do you see any defense in that, in those pre-Pauline creeds of the early church that actually would support like the earliest views of a higher Christology as well as a messianic Christology?
Let me see if I answer, if I caught your question. If I haven't, come back to me. But if the question is basically what evidence do we have for an early high view of Jesus prior to Paul?
Exactly. Yeah. He took those and incorporated them into his Christology and thus just carrying it on the early tradition of the higher Christology. And if that is a plausible use as a defense, because that's what it seemed like to me when reading into it deeper.
Yes, I would simply mention some things, but what I would really recommend if you want a more thorough laying out of the argument would be to look at my book, Lord Jesus Christ, in which I, in the opening, a couple of chapters deal particularly with devotion to Jesus, Judean Christianity, and early influences upon Paul, and try to make a fairly full case there. But in brief, yes, Professor Ehrman is right. There are a number of texts in Paul's letters which are commonly agreed upon by scholars, widely agreed upon, as what should we call them? Artifacts of sort of pre-Pauline belief and practice, which are incorporated and cited by Paul in his letters precisely because they are known, recognized formulae, which he expects his readers to know and appreciate. And so, yes, the one in Romans chapter 1 there, Jesus Christ, who has been appointed or designated Son of God in power by resurrection from the dead, is one of those texts that is widely thought to be an early Christological form, probably originating in Jewish Christian circles. Well, Paul is Jewish Christian, but not in his Gentile mission, but going back to the formative circle, probably the Jerusalem church, which Paul incorporates early in the letter, so it is thought, because of the the effect immediately of saying, I and the Jerusalem church are agreed upon this thing. You'll note, by the way, that at the end of that letter, he says, I'm now on my way to Jerusalem to deliver an offering. So the Romans, the epistle to the Romans, whatever else is going on, it's written in the context of a future mission to Jerusalem to deliver this offering for Jerusalem, which, by the way, is another thing that even Pauline scholars, in my mind, routinely underestimate to their peril. I think the Jerusalem collection is absolutely central to Paul's whole Gentile mission. And the purpose of it, of course, was to signify a union of faith between his Gentile communities and the Jerusalem church. And so the logic goes early on in this letter, indeed in the opening verses, he cites a formula which may have originated from the Jerusalem church in order to signal right away we're on the same wavelength. So it's one of several passages that are thought to, in Romans you have another one, a very familiar one, Romans chapter 4, I think it's verse 25, Christ who died for our sins and was raised for our justification. The sort of almost rhythmically nature of it. You can sometimes tell them because they have a kind of almost musical cadence. And these are thought to be sort of formulae that were coined and which Paul echoes and uses quite deliberately in order to signify a kind of co-religionist a relationship with Jewish believers. And of course, the most striking one I mentioned already is the Maranatha phrase. There you have an Aramaic formula used in a Greek letter to Greek-speaking Christians, which he does not translate. And the only basis for that is obviously it means that he'd already taught them the formula and taught them what it meant so that he didn't need to translate it. I mean, if you are familiar with the liturgical tradition, people will say, let us now say the Paternoster. Now, they'll then say it in English, you know, but let us say the Paternoster, or now we will say the Gloria in Excelsis, using, in this case, Latin formulae to refer to a traditional prayer, the Lord's Prayer, or the Gloria, which forms a regular part of the Eucharistic service. Or in the Eucharistic service, one says, Kyrie eleison, Christ eleison. Nobody speaks Greek, but they use this little Greek formula. Again, the purpose being, you know what you're saying, even though you don't speak Greek, you know what those little words mean. And it's part of the ways in which you signify, we didn't invent Christianity last Tuesday, it goes back a long way, and we're part of those people. So Paul already, even within the first couple of decades, is doing something like that, teaching Aramaic formula. Interesting what he does. There are two words in Paul that are Aramaic formula. Do you know what the other one is? Abba. He teaches them the Aramaic word for God and an Aramaic invocation of Jesus. You see the dyadic nature of what I'm talking about here? In order to give them a kind of linguistic connection to their Aramaic-speaking Jewish co-religionists. So certainly the Aramaic phrase, Maranatha, is pre-Pauline mission, pre-Gentile mission, goes back to Aramaic-speaking Christians, and shows there not only the use of a belief, a high belief, but as I've emphasized over the years, it also shows a devotional practice in which Jesus is not simply called Lord, but is actually invoked as Lord in the context of corporate worship. That's a ritual action. That's devotional practice, not simply conceptual belief.
Dr. Hurtado, I'm Zach Walker, graduate student here. I would just like to know if you would comment on Paul's adaptation of the Jewish Shema prayer in 1 Corinthians 8:6, and how that would have developed, you know, the process of development for that adaptation, and why that is evidence for an early Christology of divine identity. And maybe if you know Bart Ehrman's response to that and like how you might respond to his view of that prayer.
There's an argument amongst exegetes over exactly how to capture what is going on in 1 Corinthians 8:6. So you'll have some people who will say, this is a kind of expansion, you might say, of the Shema. The Shema, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, okay? Jewish confession from Deuteronomy. And And so there's people, and of course in 1 Corinthians 8 he says, there is for us one God the Father and one Lord Jesus Christ. So you have one, it sounds similar. And so there are a number of scholars who will say what Paul has done here is to rework that confession, the Shema, so that you not only have one God, but one God and one Lord. Okay, here we go again, wait for it. It's a dyadic form of the confession. And then there are other people who would say, no, it's not. That's going too far. It's not a reworking of the Shema, but it is a statement of the significance of God and of Jesus that appropriates language, appropriates terminology from the Shema, but it isn't. It shouldn't be understood as a rephrasing of the Shema. It's actually sort of inspired by the Shema, but it's saying one God and one Lord. I actually don't give a diddly which you choose. It actually doesn't matter as far as I'm concerned. Because either way, whether you say he reworks the Shema or he simply draws upon the Shema to make a statement, the important thing is the statement that Paul makes. And the statement that Paul makes is, for us, though there may be many gods and many kyrioi, for us there's only one God the Father, from whom are all things, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things. So he makes Jesus the exclusive, in that case, agent of creation and redemption. And that's the significant thing. Whether you want to call that a rephrasing of the Shema or influenced by the Shema or whatever, I'll let exegetes argue over how they want to imagine that. But the substance of the text, I think, is fairly clear and remarkable.
I understand that Paul was probably a Pharisee and a member of the Sanhedrin. Is that correct?
Sorry, I was a...
Paul was a Pharisee and a member of the Sanhedrin. Is that correct?
He was a Pharisee. The notion that there was a fixed Sanhedrin is something that has been shown to be an error. There wasn't a fixed Sanhedrin in the time of Paul, it appears, but a Sanhedrin was called together on occasion when there was need for one to function. But he certainly was a Pharisee.
He probably was a knowledgeable person of the Old Testament.
Very definitely.
And upon his conversion to Christianity, he went to Damascus and his eyes were opened. And in his writings, he said that he went back to Tarsus for a period of time. It's my understanding, my own formulation, that while he was in Tarsus, he developed his theology of Christ. And do you share that opinion?
He developed, sorry, again?
After his conversion, he went back to Tarsus for a period of time, probably 3 or 4 years. At that particular time, he poured through the Old Testament to find Christ. In that time, during that time, he developed his theology of Christ. Did you share that opinion?
No, I wouldn't, for several reasons. One is that by Paul's own statement, much earlier than that, his initial period of activity and preaching of Christ actually occurs in Damascus, only a very short time after his Christophany experience. Matter of fact, he says that his preaching in Damascus created such a disturbance that he had to escape the city famously to try to escape the arrest of King Aretas. So he was already an active preacher, active propagandist for Christ in Damascus far earlier than the later time that he goes to Tarsus. The second thing I would say is that we have to recognize that the figure we're talking about was before his revelation experience that he describes was what he describes as a persecutor of churches. Indeed, he says he sought to destroy the Jewish Jesus movement. So there had to have been something in the beliefs and practices of these Jewish circles already at that point that aroused his zeal and the sense that this movement was sufficiently aberrant or, in his view, abnormal, that it needed to be put out of existence. So it seems to me that what Paul experiences in the famous Damascus Road experience is actually a capitulation to a view of Jesus that he had previously opposed. So I don't think of Paul very much as an innovator of Christology. He takes over the Christological views that he had previously opposed and finds himself compelled to assent to them.
The next time you see Paul, he meets up with Barnabas in Antioch, and then they go to Jerusalem for the Jerusalem Council. And that's why I formulated that opinion about Paul.
Yes, I don't think that Paul never claims that he has any innovative Christology. He does claim to be an innovator, and he does claim to have a novel gospel mission. That novel gospel mission seems to be the notion that Gentiles, non-Jews, are to be incorporated into the Abrahamic family fully as fellow members of the Abrahamic family without having to become Jews. The big issue in the earliest Jesus movement, the big issue was not Christology. The big issue was the terms on which non-Jews could be treated as members of the people of God. And there were other Jewish believers, Jewish Christian believers, so to speak, who insisted that for a Gentile to be treated as fully a member of Abraham, they needed to come under the full covenant that God made with Moses and so on, and become effectively a Jewish proselyte, as well as putting faith in Jesus. That, it seems to me, is the kind of message that the people who, in Paul's mind, were troubling the Galatian churches, seems to be the kind of message they were preaching. They were fellow Jewish believers, I think, who were basically saying to Paul's converts, you've made a good first step. You've been baptized and you put faith in Jesus. That's a really good first step. Now you need to consummate, to complete your conversion by, in the case of males, being circumcised, observing Torah, and so on. And Paul is convinced, on the basis of a revelation, he says, that God does not want Gentiles to become Jews, but that he wants to save them as Gentiles. And so he conducts a special mission, which he feels uniquely called to. So that, it seems to me, is where the innovation of Paul lies, is in the conduct of the Gentile mission. You're welcome.
Have there been any studies on how Paul has woven Christ into the Amidah, the 18 benedictions, in the first chapter of Ephesians?
Not that I know of, but I do not have an encyclopedic knowledge of that. So there may well be, but not that I know of.
No. Okay, there's an interest. If you look at the Amidah, which was being formulated at the time, there's an interesting comparison as you look at the book of Ephesians, because it follows the order of the Amidah as it's spoken by the Jews in their daily prayers.
Hmm. Okay, well, you should work that up. Or at least let's do a thorough search and see if somebody's discovered it already, but that would be interesting, yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Hurtado, on behalf of the Biblical Studies Division. And again, continuation of our work. You have a question now?
Yeah.
Okay, you got a question. Okay. Okay. Dr. Stewart.
Well, given that that we're all here this weekend because Bart Ehrman wrote a best-selling book, and Bart says there was such a diversity of Jewish belief about exaltation. And so I'm trying to think like Bart and how he would reply to the lecture that you just gave, although because I'm the Greer Herd director, I had to be in and out, so I missed certain parts of it. How would you respond if he said, okay, all the early Jews thought Jesus was exalted, but they didn't think he was exalted in the same way. There was this huge diversity of exaltation. And I know you may get a chance to do this this weekend, but maybe not. It's a freewheeling sort of a response on Saturday. So if I were to channel Bart and say, okay, Larry, I agree totally with you, but you haven't demonstrated that it's this kind of exaltation that the earliest Christians had in mind rather than some other sort, what would you say?
I was asked to write a review of Bart's book for the Christian Century, so I'll refer you to that also. But on the one hand, yes, I think Bart is correct that in the early period, the earliest period of the first century, roughly, Jews and so-called Christians, early members of the Jesus movement, may well have had a variety of ways in which they referred to Jesus' exalted status. And these are different, all of them in some sense, are different from, or distinguishable, let's put it that way, distinguishable, I don't mean contradiction, but distinguishable from the kind of formula and categories that come to be used, say, in the 3rd century, 4th century, 5th century Christological debates. Those are the ones that we're more familiar with because they've influenced the creeds that we use. And so, for example, in particularly beginning probably in the 2nd century, even with Justin Martyr, but certainly on into the 4th century, 5th century, we have the dominant sort of categories that are being used by Christians are categories that they draw from philosophical traditions of the time, both Platonistic and also Aristotelian categories. And so one of the questions that comes out is the use of the term essence. Is Jesus of the same essence as God? The Greek word ousia or the Latin word substantia. Are they the same substantia or are they different? That's a valid question, but those aren't the kind of categories or questions that Paul and early Jews and Jewish believers were facing. So I don't know that either side can claim them directly as answering those questions. So they're distinguishable, but I think that would be an error on the one hand to say Paul believed in Nicene Christology. It would also be an error to say Paul disagreed with Nicene Christology. Bart would have to answer for himself, but I think there are places in it where he appears to be doing the latter. So he will say in the book, for Paul, Jesus is divine, but he's not God Almighty. Well, nowhere in the early church do people say Jesus is God Almighty. Hopantokrator is always reserved for God until the Byzantine period, at least. So in the first several centuries, Pantokrator, Almighty, is a term that is reserved for God the Father. It is never applied to Christ. So to say Paul doesn't think of Jesus as God Almighty is like, tell me something I don't know. And it gives the impression that there's some kind of denial of a later formulation that's going on. But, Henry Ford's Model T didn't have power steering. That doesn't mean that he rejected power steering. It means it wasn't invented yet. Okay? So it's both true to say the Model T doesn't have power steering. It would be incorrect to say, unlike modern automobiles, it did not have power steering. As if he thought about it and thought, heck no, I think people ought to be able to use their arms. You know? So there is a bit of a misleading play. Perhaps, I don't know if it's unintentional or not. I think it may well be unintentional because Bart wrote his book as a popular book and wrote it in part to challenge and antagonize a large part of the population that accounts for his remarkable sales, which are fundamentalist traditional Christians who find him a thorn in the flesh and therefore go out and buy his book because they find it annoying. And it works. It's great. And can I also say that Bart assures me that the income that he makes off his books and the fat income that you're giving him for coming here, he assures me that he donates to his favorite charities. He's a good-hearted guy. He's not building a a mansion in Carolina. He claims to have given a six-figure sum already to the charities that he supports. So you can buy his book in good conscience, whether you like it or not. It goes to a good cause, apparently. But part of the reason for the success is that he both reassures those who want to say that Christian faith is rubbish, and he antagonizes those who are traditional Christians, and both people buy his books. It's a great formula. I wish I'd thought of it first, but I didn't. So I think that part of the point that he's making is, in subsequent Christian thought, and as I've said, particularly also in Christian piety, populist Christian piety, I'm sorry, I don't mean to be talking down, but insufficiently tutored Christian piety, there is a persistent tendency down the ages to treat Jesus as God. I mean, he's the only God there is. Jesus is God. There's no Father. There's just Jesus. You pray to Jesus, he's the judge. I've heard people even say, "Our Heavenly Father, dear Lord Jesus." And so it's that kind of elision of the Father, so to speak, that kind of untutored way of referring to Jesus, in part, that Barth is probably reacting to when he says, "Jesus is divine for Paul, but he's not God Almighty." He wants to say, not like that sort of popular piety. And that's true. If you were to ask Paul, for example, if we could bring Paul back on stage for a moment, and with what is it, if we had the DNA, I guess we could probably do that at some point. But bring him back on stage and say, "Paul, do you believe that Jesus was of the same ousia as God the Father?" My guess is that his initial response would be to say, "What? I don't understand the question." They didn't think in those categories. However, it's interesting, if you look at the categories that were available to these Jewish Christians in this early period, what categories were available? They tended to be the categories that derive from biblical and Jewish tradition. So, for example, what are the distinctive ways in which you speak of God? God's name is unique. And so you have this strange kind of language in Deuteronomy. God says, "I will cause my name to dwell in the temple." You think, what? Cause my name to what? It's not the way we think, but it's Jewish language. God's name is himself in some kind of way. And Paul says in Philippians 2, "And God gave him the name above every name." That is, Jesus is given to share in the name of God. God's throne, God rules over all things. And Paul says, Jesus sits at the right hand of God, shares the divine throne, and rules as God's plenipotentiary. God is the creator of all things, and Paul says Jesus is the one, the vehicle through whom God made all things. So in every way that, in terms of every category, so to speak, that was in the cupboard at the time, all of those categories are used to speak of Jesus' significance. Another one is glory, kavod. The divine kavod, glory. And Jesus says the glory of God is, that Jesus shares and reflects the glory of God. So name, glory, throne, all of the ways in which you speak of God's uniqueness in biblical and Jewish tradition are drawn upon in order, and so to speak, extended, you might say, to enfranchise Jesus within that same kind of discourse. It's what my friend Richard Baucom means, I think, when he talks about Jesus being included within the divine identity. That's a bit of an abstraction for me, but I think that's what he means, is that the way in which you talk about God's uniqueness gets extended in early Christian usage to incorporate Jesus along with God in that kind of discourse. So, yes, it's distinguishable, factually, phenomenologically distinguishable from the kind of discourse that you have later, but that doesn't mean they're at counterposed with each other. That's saying more than the evidence allows. You can't say one is the other, and you can't say they're in contradiction with each other. They're just different.
Any others? Well, if not, just again to thank Dr. Picado.
other thing about your about the blog site and the introduction. I don't talk down to people who don't know enough. What I do lose patience with is people who don't know anything but claim and make assertions as if they did. There's nothing blameworthy about being ignorant. I'm ignorant of all kinds of things. But I wouldn't dare pontificate on dental surgery or nuclear physics or whatever. But there are blockheads out there who don't know a diddly about Greek, Latin, Coptic, Aramaic, or the ancient world, but who feel free to pontificate about it. They shall remain unnamed. Those are the people I lose patience with. Sorry.
All right, we'll just encourage you again tomorrow afternoon at 2 o'clock with Michael Byrd for the Theological and Historical Division lectureship that will be then followed tomorrow evening by the beginning of the Greer Heard Point Counterpoint with our all-illustrious friend, Bart Ehrman. So thank you for coming. Have a great evening. See you tomorrow.